It's race day on the Wellington waterfront, the Monte Carlo of the South Pacific. The 1989 Nissan Mobile 500 is 1 hour and 45 minutes away from a start. It's a windy day as the streets of the harbour capital come alive. The green light will flash at 1:45 for the 500 kilometre or 4 hour event. The race traditionally goes the 4 hour distance. Last year's winners, Roberto Revaglia and Emanuele Pirro, raced 152 laps of the 3.21 kilometre circuit. Good afternoon, everybody. Revaglia and Pirro are back to win again in their brilliant Schnitzer BMW M3. To win today, though, they're going to have to withstand both mechanical problems with their car, which we understand are quite serious with the race an hour and three quarters away from a start, and also they're going to withstand the challenge of these super-fast Ford Sierras. Peter Brock, who's won here twice before in a Holden Commodore, raced in a BMW last year, has gone across to the Sierra team with the mobile car. So Peter Brock is on pole position for the race, and don't disregard either the Nissans. They missed last year, but with top driving talent like Wyn Percy, Jim Richards and George Feary, they're going to be a factor in this afternoon's race, I'm sure. Let's go to the commentary box now and join our team, anchored by Tony Palmer.
Thanks, Peter. Hi, everybody, up here in the windy Belfry, where we're looking forward to another Nissan Mobile for 1989. It is windy up here, and we think it's going to affect them on the track, and we hope the rain is going to stay away. I think the race is going to be exciting because there are several contenders there who could win it. Commentating with me, Trevor Crowe and David Oxton, both of whom have driven here, both of whom know the circuit very well. We'll be joined later in the afternoon also by some guest commentators. Meantime, let's meet our pits crew.
Hello, I'm John Cardwell. Welcome to the pits. This is where the race is won or lost.
Good afternoon, I'm Brian Lawrence. We'll be keeping you up to date with the action here in the pits as it happens.
And this is where we get to meet and talk to the drivers in the Nissan Mobile 500.
Pretty breezy down there on pit lane. Here's what we have for you in the next 6 hours. We begin in just a few moments with the Thunder Saloons. And we had a fantastic race yesterday between Wayne Huxford and Roger Freeth. Will we see it again this afternoon? At 12:15, the Kiwi Red Aerobatics display starts. That's followed by the United U-Plan Celebrity Race. 10 in the field with Rod Dixon back to defend his title. And during that race, we'll have highlights of this morning's Formula Pacific race featuring the young Hamilton driver Craig Baird and Canadian Jacques Villeneuve, brother of the late Formula One driver Gilles Villeneuve. We wind up at 1 for the news review program, that's the news program for the deaf, and we're back at 1:30, counting down to the start of the big race at 1:45 this afternoon. Well, our first racing action for you this afternoon is from the Thunder Saloons, the big sports sedans. Yesterday it was a fantastic scrap door-to-door between Wayne Huxford in the Capri and Roger Freeth in the Toyota Starlet. Let's see what happened in this afternoon's race, which was held just a few minutes ago.
Thanks, Peter. I love these cars. 8 laps for the Lucas Thunder Saloons, and watch for Wayne Huxford and Roger Freeth out front again. Freethy's got out there first. Where's Huxford? Roger Freeth out on his own. Huxford's got a bad start. It looks like he's out. Well, he's getting around the corner, but gone is our battle, the two-way battle we saw yesterday. And it'll be Roger Freeth to lead them round. We might see the Nissan 300 of Kane Scott's coming up through the field this time too. Qualified well, there is Huxford.
That's a big shame, Tony, because yesterday these two had a wonderful battle. It was really just door to door the whole race, and we were really looking forward to seeing that again. Roger probably now is going to have a pretty easy time of it. He's had the car really well sorted for here, and he's just going to get up and run away, unfortunately.
So Roger Freeth out to a comfortable lead already. Looks like Osborne behind him, and then Kane Scott.
John Osborne's actually going very well. He's put a lot of effort into this race. He's rebuilt his motor. He's got a lot of new parts in it. He's fairly hyped up for it, but somehow his big car doesn't seem to suit the circuit quite as much as Roger Freeth. Freeth's got his arm out the window, which is a little unusual.
Quite sure what that signal is.
He's got trouble. Goodness me, we've lost the two quickest cars in the first lap. What a shame. Puts John Osborne in a very good position.
Well, I hate to say something to you, Trevor, but I mean, I have to remind you that yesterday I said we were only halfway through a full contest, and, well, they haven't even managed a lap. They've even broken their own good record. Usually they manage half a race.
So it's John Osborne from Kane Scott and Brent Willis at the moment, then go back to Robbie Francovic.
Yes, you're right, David. The old hand grenade description of these cars seems to be coming back to haunt them. But really, this season they have looked, but they have really been much more professional.
Well, that's fine. We can recreate the interest because John Osborne out front, who had an excellent race yesterday in third place,
is now going to be challenged by this very, very hot car that they've had very little time to sort, the 300 ZX, right in his mirrors there. And he's in a battle with Brett Willis.
Yes, I think the thing about the Nissan is they've had very little practice in the car, and I think even as the race goes on, he'll get quicker and quicker as he comes to terms with the car and with the circuit. I think the car arrived something like a week ago, and they've virtually untouched it since the way it ran in America.
So Roger Freed, he'll be a very disappointed man now. The only consolation he has is knowing that Huxford went out before he did. These two, as we've said, battled door-to-door yesterday. So now Johnny Osborne out on the lead, being chased by Kane Scott in the big Nissan. Just look at that gap. It's actually, Osborne has just pulled out a little more in the last half lap or so.
Well, these sprint races, of course, don't allow any pit work to be successful. Just literally, you can't stop at all. Eight laps, it's just no contest. The bonnet on that car of John Osborne is flapping. Is that really by design, Trevor, or is it just a bit sort of, a bit weak today?
Well, I could tell you that he's got it that way to let the air out from under the bonnet, but I noticed he had it that way at practice yesterday. It seemed to last the practice, so I don't think it's going to worry him.
That's got to be about one of the wildest Mazdas in the world. I'm sure when the Mazda comes on TV and we look at MX-5s and RX-3s, I bet Rod Millen never planned on seeing a car like that.
No, it's actually got a 364 cubic inch chev in it, which relates to a lot of horsepower, and it's probably a little heavier than, for instance, Roger Freed's car, so on these bumpy circuits he's at a slight disadvantage. On the open circuits, of course, it's a lot more able to stretch its legs.
And those of us still thinking in imperial measures, somewhere around 6 litre. Look at how much Kane Scott's getting a tail slewed in this thing. It's great to watch. It's obviously going to have the horsepower as the season goes on and he gets a chance to develop it.
Probably means that they haven't got the car quite set up the way they want, because really you want to be able to put your foot down pretty early and not have it slide out like that.
Oh, don't take all the pleasure away from the spectators.
Sorry about that.
So what are the Oscar supporters think of having hairdryers in the Formula now, Trevor? Like, turbos is just not your language. They've got to have 6 litres and sort of 10 carburetors before they're really accepted down south, haven't they?
Yes, that's right. Oscar's been going for about 15 years, and that's John Osborne's car is really based on an Oscar car. And they don't tend to run turbochargers because they get quite heavy penalties for that.
So the order of the race, still John Osborne from Kane Scott, Brett Willis, Robbie Francovic and Greg Lancaster, then Don Grindley. John Osborne having it all his own way. And we'll get a word with the man who should have been at the front of this race and was very, very briefly till he went out on lap one, Roger Freed.
Okay, Roger, what happened out there?
It appears as though an oil pump drive belt's broken. I don't know, it might have picked up a stone and got caught in the pulley and it's broken the belt and we've lost oil pressure. So, we got to pull out in that circumstance. Yep. It's killed the motor.
What happened to Wayne? Did you see what happened to him?
No, I just saw on the pace car lap he pulled over on the side. I don't know what the problem was. There was no smoke or anything. I don't know at all. Haven't got a clue.
David Oxton up there saying your hand grenades. What are you going to say about that?
No, our engine, there's not a problem with the engine. I think what's happened is the stones got caught under a belt. There's quite a lot of small stones here. We've already had trouble with punches with them. I think that's what's done it.
Roger, thanks very much.
Thanks.
Hard luck so for Roger Freed, and we've got a problem there. Steve Pearson in the Renault R12 with the V8 in it. It's a Rover 3.5 litre V8 in the car. Obviously overcooking it on that corner. On the final lap now for John Osborne, winning this race from Kane Scott and Brett Willis. They've had a good battle too. Osborne now with a fairly clear lead. And those spacings, first, second and third, staying that way. The V8 Rover-powered Renault, still upside down. We hear the drivers all right. The fire crew just staying there in case it gets any nasty flames licking up there. But this is last lap for John Osborne. Well, I know he's going to be pleased because he does work hard, as Trevor Crowe has said, to get on the pace, and he goes out and drives very, very aggressively. He occasionally has some run-ins with official Lindman Motorsport, but he's a nice fellow underneath it all. John's a real Jekyll and Hyde, actually. When he's behind the wheel, his eyes light up and he becomes a different person. When you talk to him on his own, he's a really peaceful chappy and a really nice bloke. So maybe most racing drivers have that tendency, of course.
It sounds like you, Trevor.
Thank you very much.
We wouldn't want to say that most racing drivers become animals when they get behind the wheel. That's not true. It doesn't happen till the flag drops. Here he comes around now on his final lap, down to the checkered flag. He's got less than a quarter of the circuit to complete as he's over the Dunlop Bridge. And approaching the front straight now, John Osborne and the Chev V8 powered Mazda RX-7 wins the race. In second place, Kane Scott in the Nissan, and Brett Willis will be third. That's the way they finished, Osborne, Scott and Willis.
You know, a 500 kilometre race around Wellington, I think it's a matter of not making any mistakes and keeping going, and the guys doing a good job in the pits, and you have to have all the variables right to win this race.
It's a challenge, this circuit. You can't make a mistake. I actually enjoy it as much as any other circuit we race on. It's a track you can be very, very aggressive, you can drive very, very hard, and it's a great place. I enjoy the race.
Nissan Mobil 500 starts in an hour and a half from now at a quarter to two. But now I'd like to introduce you to one of the highlights of this year's festival here on the streets of Wellington as we leave the tarmac on the Wellington waterfront and go up in the sky. It's time for the Kiwi Red display, and Jug Jackson, Flight Lieutenant Jug Jackson from the Kiwi Red squad, delight to have you with us. Tell us a little bit about what we're going to see this afternoon, Jack.
Well, first of all, it's good to be here, Peter. It's good to be back this year. We're a little bit in the dark, actually, as to what the wing commander is in fact going to do with the team. I've been unable to contact him on the radio here, and I think probably the producers are a little bit in the dark as well. So when I see it, I'll be able to describe it to you. In fact, we've got a shot of them there, and Delta, I think they're probably holding at the moment. They're probably trying to talk to me, in fact. But the weather today in Wellington is not ideal for formation. Unfortunately, the wind is very strong, and this causes a lot of air turbulence, makes things fairly difficult the guys that are trying to stay in formation, and there's a little bit of low cloud around, but probably not enough that's going to really affect the display, so I'm sure the boss will try and get in as much as he can for us.
So they'll be underway in just a few moments from now. Jug, we heard of course about that tragic accident featuring Kiwi Red a few months ago. How much has that affected you as you plan for both this display and also for the Commonwealth Games opening and closing ceremonies display?
Well, it's a very tragic loss, first of all. Graham was a friend of all of ours, and it's a real loss to the team, to the squadron and to the Air Force. However, we can't dwell on the fact that he has gone. We replaced him fairly quickly in the team. I think it's testament to the guys. They're up flying only 2 days after the accident. And since then, they've brought back the team together as a six. They've been flying together every day, and they're now up, and I think they're probably flying as good as what they ever have been.
All right, Jug, well, there's six of you, or six of them in the squad. Tell us a bit about the Skyhawks. What speeds can they reach? What sort of capabilities do they have?
Well, it's first and foremost, US Navy designed jet attack bomber, if you like, fighter bomber. In fact, if you look at them on the screen at the moment, I'm not really sure where that footage is coming from. Before there, we saw a little bit of a jet cam film taken from inside the boss's jet.
This is live, Jack.
Okay, well, then we can see them in Atlas there. And they'll be pulling up into the vertical and doing a bomb burst at the top.
Magnificent.
What's this,
live coverage.
Of course, a bit of class has got in the way there, but all the men go to a different point on the compass when we shot from the helicopter.
What sort of speeds are they flying at in this display, Jack?
The fastest speed that is reached during this display is done by Red Fine, whenever they hopefully we'll see a little bit later on. And he's reaching upwards of 1,100 kilometres an hour as he's coming towards the crowd there. There we see the jet cam picture again, that's taken from, I say, Wing Commander John Bates's jet, the team leader, and he's looking backwards over his shoulder in the two-seater A4 she's flying.
Now, what sort of altitude are they at, Jack?
Well, at the moment, I would say he's up around about 2,000 feet. And you'll see his head frantically moving around the cockpit, trying to reposition himself in his formation for the next maneuver. You can just see off to the right there, one of the men hanging off his wing. They'll be having a fairly hard job of it today, I would imagine, with this wind. The wind plus the old Wellington Hills seem to make things fairly difficult. A lot of mechanical turbulence for them to compete with.
Jack, in fact, we've just heard from the flight commander, John Bates, that the conditions are against the display this afternoon. So with the cloud and the strong winds here, they've decreed that it's too dangerous. So it's a great disappointment to the crowd here, because it has been traditionally last year, and we have this, a great highlight of the Streets Alive Festival during the Nissan Mobile 500. So what do you say to the fact that they've called it off?
Well, first and foremost, in any flying display, particularly when the public is concerned, we have to fly safe. And that is the primary concern, is the fact that the formation must be safe to both the pilots and to the people on the ground. So he's made that decision on a lot of years of experience in aerobatics, and I'm sure he's made it for a very good reason. And the turbulence must be pretty bad if they've had to knock it off. As you know, Harkier is not that calm at the best of times.
That's right. Gale force winds were forecast for today. They've certainly come true. We must be having the odd gusts at up 40, 50 knots at least, I would think.
Oh, easily. We've had a good gust of about 40 knots on the ground today. And I imagine the wind tends to get a lot stronger as you get up a bit. It's a bit of a shame they've had to knock it off, but they'll be heading back to Ahakia and jumping in a van, driving back down, and hopefully catch the big race this afternoon. So you'll probably see them later on.
All right, Joe, we'd like to do a little public relations exercise for Kiwi Red from the 75 Squadron. We've got some action, some shots of them in action during yesterday's display. But perhaps also if you could tell us a little bit more about the future plans for Kiwi Red. We mentioned you're going to be at the Commonwealth Games opening and closing ceremonies, but also you're doing a tour of the main centres in February, March next year.
Yes, the team was primarily formed for the opening and closing of the Commonwealth Games next year. And we're going to take part in the celebrations for New Zealand 1990. And to that end, we'll be doing displays around all the major centres in the North and South Island. And that'll be taking place right up until the 1st of April, which is in fact our final display.
Well, in fact, we've got videotape here of yesterday's display, and perhaps you can just do a little commentary and tell us exactly what's happening here, Jack.
Certainly. Yesterday we had a very, very nice day for it, in fact. Wellington turned on one of its better days. And you can see them there. They're in the V for Victory or Vic formation. There's only the five aircraft there, Red 5, Lieutenant Herb Keatley. He'll be sitting out somewhere towards Eastbourne waiting to join the formation. And you'll see there, that's the jet cam picture from Wing Commander's jet, pulling up over the top for a loop, and that's probably a view of Wellington you don't see every day.
So that again is about 2,000 feet, is it?
In fact, the Skyhawk, when we're pulling up for these manoeuvres, we're starting at about 800 kilometres an hour. And we use up quite a bit of sky on the vertical just performing a simple loop. They would have used about 6,000 feet in the vertical there, which is a little bit over a mile. So quite high. And they're bottoming out at about 500 feet above us there, over the harbour.
Now there's only five in that formation. Where's the other one at this time?
Bruce Keatley will be out. He'll be attempting to rejoin the formation from the Eastbourne direction. He was previously that man that went straight up performing all the vertical rolls, and he topped out above us at about 3 miles. And he's now coming back down to chase and catch the formation up. In fact, we just caught a glimpse of him coming through there. He's got quite a mass problem here. You see him trailing towards the back, and he's got to match turning circles and speeds to try and get in. Now, the man on the extreme left of that formation, flying off to Craig Mitchell, he'll be sliding back into line of stern, which is his more normal position, directly behind Red 1, Wing Commander John Bates, and Bruce Keatley will be taking his position in the formation. And we have the helicopter view of that. You may be able to see a air-to-air refueling hose there trailing from the Wing Commander's jet. This comes off a air-to-air refueling store underneath the aircraft. And Red 4 will be attempting to plug into that with a stroke. In fact, you can see he's got on there straight away. We use this air refueling as to enhance our operational capability on the Skyhawk, as a means of transferring fuel from one aircraft to the other.
So there is a practical element to this aerobatics display.
Yes, well, the jet is purpose designed for weapons delivery and being a fighter. It wasn't specifically made for aerobatics, so everything that you're seeing today is actually used in our everyday operational flying. You just saw the team there performing rollbacks as they pass over the back of Mount Victoria. And they're now in a formation that we call Swan. This is where the outside men have slid back to formate directly off Red 4, who's attached to Red 1's jet there. These manoeuvres, well, they're plugged in this air-to-air refuelling motor. In fact, unique to the Kiwi Red aerobatic team. Only team in the world that actually performs these manoeuvres when they are plugged. And hopefully we'll see the barrel roll a little bit later on. This barrel roll was first attempted in 1983 with the Kiwi Red aerobatic team. In fact, then, however, it was only two aircraft. And in the subsequent teams, they've worked it up to four aircraft. And this year is the first year they've ever had all six aircraft in the same formation while performing this. As you can see, the day was a little bit better yesterday, more congested aerobatics.
A little bit clearer and not quite so much wind.
Oh, it's a beautiful day.
It's a magnificent sight. This is Kiwi Red from 75 Squadron of the RNZAF at Ohakia, the aerobatics team, air-to-air refuelling.
In fact, we can see them there pulling up for a barrel roll. And as I say, the only team in the world that actually performs this maneuver. Fairly difficult formation to fly. And they'll be topping out there at about 3,500 feet, and there's the jet cam picture of it.
So the climax to the display coming up, Jack?
Yes, well, there's a couple of manoeuvres to go. I'm not too sure how they've edited this as they've gone along, but we'll certainly have a look. We're coming up towards the final manoeuvres of the show. And you can see as they're pulling up there in the right-hand wing over, the wing commander's actually retracting that fueling hose now. And they'll be speeding up. And they'll be changing back into a formation that we call Delta. You can see he's just called the team up there. That's a nice sharp arrowhead formation. Really sets off that nice sharp sweep-back wing that the A4 has. And also as a product of this sweep-back wing, the pilots can get in there and fly nice and tight formation in the wing. The inter-aircraft spacing there is only a matter of about 4 to 6 feet. The wing commander has to extend right out towards Eastbourne because he has to get in a loop before he can perform his final bomb burst. And here they're pulling up in a loop coming directly towards us. In fact, that man second from the right from the wing commander is in fact a local boy, flying officer Graham Dawson. You might remember him from last year, Peter. He was in here commentating.
That's right, he was in your seat, Jack.
And as I say, he's a local lad, and I was chatting to him prior to the display yesterday, and he's very pleased to be back performing aerobatics over his home city.
Well, a fantastic sight of videotape from yesterday's display. Just repeating again that today's display had to be cancelled because of the weather. It's very windy here in Wellington, and we have some low cloud as well. Now, Jug, you've got some fundraising activities going on with Kiwi Red at the moment that you'd like to mention, I'm sure.
Yes, we've got our little sales here that follows us around on our displays, wherever we do them. Down there, we're selling them for a variety of various patches, some of the ones you can see here, and there's some more on display down there as well. And we've got buttons, and with every purchase made, you get a free booklet, which is the Kiwi Red booklet for this year, and it's very interesting.
And if you'd like further information, number 75 Squadron RNZAF Base, Ohakia in Palmerston North.
Please, if you wish to write to us for any information, do so.
All right, Jack Jackson, thank you very much for coming to join us. We should say that that's not his real name. He's actually Flight Lieutenant Robert Jackson, but known everywhere apparently as Jug. Thanks for being with us, Jug.
Thank you,
Peter. And we'll return to the Wellington waterfront very soon for the United U-Plan Celebrity Race.
Been here four times and I've never won, so let's hope and keep our fingers crossed for this weekend.
Yeah, I like the street race. I was also in Macau and I won one time in Macau, and it's not bad.
Comments from some of the drivers in this afternoon's big race, just over an hour and a quarter away from the start. 1:45 it begins, but now we sort of get away from the serious stuff and have a bit of light-hearted racing. This is the United U-Plan Celebrity Race. It was my pleasure and privilege to have a go in it last year. Rod Dixon is the only one of last year's field who's come back. Rod Dixon, the winner of last year's race. I'm delighted to say I came second last. The Television New Zealand sports representative in this year's race is Jeffrey Bryan, and Fenella Bathfield and Jude Kirk are also in the field. They've got their fans there. Let's go to Tony Palmer up in the commentary box now and take a look at the action in the celebrity race this year.
Thanks, Peter. We won't say too much about your exploits in this last year. I seem to remember David Oxton and I having great difficulty trying to talk you around the circuit. It happened to be wet at the time. And there's the man that really wants to win again, Rod Dixon. He's in car one. Car two is Judith Kirk. David Longy is in three. Fiona Cram, the winner of the
Krypton Factor on television is in car 4. Murray Pierce, the All Black, in 5. Fenella Barfield is on 6. Jim Hopkins is in 9. Number 8 is Jeff Bryant. 7 is Waimaramatau Manu. And Hamish Piercy, who was the winner of a contest to get into this race, and turned out to be the second fastest qualifier. Expect Rod Dixon to repeat his performance of last year. His qualifying time of 2:02.75, but we really shouldn't say too much or predict too much, because yesterday in practice there was carnage everywhere. There were broken cars all over the circuit, and Dougal, I just hope that they've got enough machinery to replace these things.
Well, Fiona Slam, as we've called her, or Crash Cram, had quite a bad accident. In fact, wrote one of these Sentras off. I trust she won't be entering the Krypton Factor again next year. Heaven help us if she does. But she was going extremely well. In fact, the women yesterday in practice were all bunched within half a second of each other. A little faster than last year. These cars are on better Yokohama tyres. They've got a new engine, 3-valve engine, 12-valve motors, of course, and they're about 10% up on horsepower last year, which means really that Rob Dixon should be going just a touch quicker than he is, don't you?
I'd have thought so, yes. And he was given a really good run for his money yesterday by Hamish Piercy, and then eventually they were racing so closely that Rodney Dixon ended up with a large dent in the door.
Yes, well, of course, this is the United U-Plan Challenge, and just there yesterday, Rob Dixon went into the United U-Plan War, touched base, as it were.
Magnetic appeal.
Quite. The other thing, the competition that Hamish Piercy won to get a drive in the celebrity race was in fact drawn by the Attorney General, David Longhi, who's completing this race as well. So I suppose to some extent the Attorney General has been the architect of his own misfortune.
And David Oxon, I know that they had some lessons up at Ohakia Airfield on how to drive these from people like Jim Richards and George Furey and Mark Scape. And when we asked them, having come back from that instruction, whether or not there was any talent out there, they said, well, don't hold your breath.
Well, it's very hard at short notice to sort of put a lot of talent on this track, but Prime Minister Dave, or ex-Prime Minister Dave, has probably got the most form.
Rod Dixon was the winner, as we know. Actually quite impressed with Big Dave's takeoff from the grid. I mean, he just halved into the centre of the road.
Try to make some ground. Look at car number 3, Dave Longhi. But try and get the camera angles on the sides. Obviously, these cars are absolutely identical in every way, not just in appearance, but in their specification horsepower. To make it all fair and equal to all drivers, they've actually been tuned identically. I can vouch for that because it was done on my own tuning shop dyno, and they are absolutely fair contests. But
I'd say this contest is rigged from the outset.
Yes.
He's got shares with you. Rod Dixon's in the lead. Now, you trained him last year, didn't you?
Well, he's come on well, young Rod. He hasn't spoken to me about it this year, but I'm sure he hasn't forgot the rules. And, well, if that's the lead in one lap, yes, he's doing a good job.
He had a fantastic beginning, didn't he? Just like last year.
Defending champion always has to prove it wasn't a fluke the first year. And we've got a lot of guys who really would like to beat me, and I think that in itself is pressure. The excitement of it all, a little bit of pressure there not to do too much damage to the cars. Probably a little aggressive in our practice this morning, because we did do some damage, and I mean, you like to keep the cars clean for Nissan's sake.
What's your opinion of the new circuit?
Great. Actually, I think it's a lot easier than last year, but I think really that they've made it a lot safer with the barriers. They've made it a lot safer taking out some of those nasty little corners down the end of the beginning of the front straight, and a little bit more at the other end at the tight hairpin. That's a little easier to approach that now. You can start to see it coming up, although Fiona didn't.
Have you been doing the same training this year in your running shoes as you did last year?
Go out at 7 o'clock each morning and do a few laps, see where you're going to go and see what you're going to do.
Who do you see as your toughest opposition this year?
I think Hamish, who is the guest celebrity. And although David Longhi had just a quiet, steady run, and I think tomorrow he'll be a lot more aggressive. Then I think Murray Pierce. Murray Pierce was always in sight of us, so I think he'll be up there with us.
Rod, thank you.
Well, surprise, surprise, the person in second place at the moment, it wasn't her that just had a spin, by the way, that was Hamish Piercy. He was getting awfully upside yesterday and very, very close to Rod Dixon's pace. But the person in second place is Judith Kirk in car 2. The hostess from TVNZ's Sail of the Century show is chasing Rodney Dixon at the moment. And that's the length of gap between them. In third place was Hamish Piercy. He's just lost that. Murray Pierce, the All Black, was tacking up in fourth place. This is how it happened. Get it all wrong one way, then it overcorrects, and once it starts doing that, it's...
I'm sure Jim Richards didn't teach her to come do that.
Well, Hamish, of course, has done some driver training with the police college instructors up at Manfield. This track is very different from Manfield, as David Oxton will attest. Judith Kirk was really enjoying herself yesterday. Of course, she said that she was very happy to be driving. She particularly enjoyed herself, and she was very stimulated by it.
Well, we know Rod Dixon's had some experience and some training. If Jude Kirk can stay there in second place, we might have some new driving talent here.
Precisely.
Do you think Mr. Nissen might have got out there and given these drivers a bit of a talking to last night? Because there was a bit of carnage. I mean, it's all fun, but we don't like seeing these cars destroyed like they were yesterday.
Actually, Rod was doing quite a lot of thinking about it yesterday. He went right around the track with Ray Williams, a very experienced driver. Every corner they discussed. In fact, they spent some hours discussing the track, so he must know this track like the back of his hand. But there was some suggestion there was too much carnage yesterday, but people take this very seriously. Jim Hopkins said they got exhilarated. In fact, what was the other quote I read this morning? It was a combination of orgasm and execution. But you'd expect that from Jim.
As they say in the publicity, if Jim Hopkins can drive as well as he debates, there'll be no contest.
Dougal, when are you going to have a celebrity debate on that?
I'll tell you what, Murray Pierce, the All Black, is catching Jude Kirk. He's in third, and he's catching Jude Kirk in second place. That's where the battle is at the moment, second and third, because Rod Dixon really has just run away in first. There's Dixon through. You have a look at the gap back. It's quite substantial. Car number eight, by the way, is our own Jeff Bryan. He's a little off the pace at the moment. Let's see if we can get a word with him in a minute, if he's not too busy. Let's see if we can get a word with Jeff Bryan anyway.
Jeff, you're used to being in the hot seat. How different is it being in the real hot seat?
Oh, Trish, it's wonderful being out there. A wonderful course, and thanks to Nissan too for the opportunity to do it, because it's just great to get in there. My main worry is Rod Dixon, that graduate of the Ayrton Senna School of Driving, who's likely to take us all out on the way.
They say this is a real driver's circuit. You make one mistake, you're in the wall. How worried are you?
I'm not particularly, because I'm a very gentle man, Trish, and I intend to apply that to my driving as well.
Are you out to win?
No, I'm taking a very Corinthian attitude into this race. I intend to enjoy myself, and if everybody else happens to stack it in the wall, then I might come out on top. But otherwise, no, I'm just here to enjoy myself.
Well, he's sitting in seventh place at the moment, and quite a long ways off the pace if we look at the lap times. He's about 7 or 8 seconds down. Rod Dixon taking it very, very seriously. Jude Kirk still in second. Murray Pierce is in third place.
What's happened to Hamish Piercy? He had that spin. He was very aggressive yesterday in practice. He touched doors with Rod Dixon. He was right on the pace within a second of Rod's best time.
Doesn't seem to be recovering, but this is where the battle is second and third. It looks like Pierce has gone through underneath. He has. Pierce, the All Black.
That was a classic piece of overtaking, David.
Well, as they say in the trade, Judith left the door open. I bet she won't do that very often, but there again, she gave the place away, and Murray got through, and All Blacks, well, sportsmen are at the front of the queue.
Come on, I thought it was actually a very, very clever piece of dicing there and hopping underneath. That's where the battle is, though, between Jude Kirk and Murray Pierce. A great race they're having. They seem to be keeping off the walls well enough and keeping quite good pace. Because they are dicing, of course, Rod Dixon has been allowed to get away in front. And look at Jude Kirk, he's not going to let him get away.
Has really set himself up with a big lead.
Now Jude Kirk flies aeroplanes too, doesn't she? So she probably has some of the nous to be able to do this well. She's not fazed by the pressure. And look at Rod Dixon's lead. We know he likes winning, but does he have to do it by this much?
I'd like to see his times. I mean, it ill behoves me to display any envy because I'm not in the so-called celebrity race this year. But I set the fastest time last year. I'd like to see Rod with 10% more power, with better tyres and more training, do a little faster, don't you?
I see the fellow waving a little yellow flag up there. I don't know whether it's just to keep some action, but we'll look around for any possible carnage going into the last lap. One lap to go for Rod Dixon, and a good tight battle here. That's some action here on screen.
That was Pierce. Jude Kirk right behind him. Getting awfully close to the fence there. But making the corner.
Oh!
Whoa! Not everybody makes the quarter here, and that's the place that we keep talking about, where you will see people going straight ahead.
I think that may have been the Attorney General.
I think it was the Attorney General. He's rewriting the statute books there.
You'd think you'd know these streets of Wellington well enough. Now there's another battle developing here in third and fourth places. Hamish Piercy, I think, getting back into the act. Duke Kirk slipping back into the grips just a little. On the final lap, Rod Dixon with his big lead. There's Pierce in second place in car five. Then Duke Kirk.
Then Hamish Piercy.
A potential for a bit of door banging here, I think, isn't it, guys?
You'd think so, wouldn't you? Those three close together. This Hamish Piercy, my goodness, isn't he aggressive? In practice yesterday all day, he was pushing Rod Dixon hard, and they had quite similar lap times until Rod Dixon managed to get away. This time Dixon got the clean start and just ran off. Now, he has aspirations to get into motorsport, Rod Dixon. Said he'd like to have a go at a 12-hour race or a production race.
Well, Rod approaches these things extremely professionally, as I explained. Get the maximum enjoyment out of it, he puts the maximum effort in, and it certainly pays off. Besides which, I'd have to admit he has some natural talent.
Yeah, seems to have some car control, doesn't he?
A fair bit of garbage blowing around on the circuit there. That's going to be watched for the big race, the Nissan Mobile. It's due to start at 1:45, because if that gets into things like oil coolers, fan belts and various areas, it can cause havoc. No problems in this race. The Nissan Sentra race for Rod Dixon within half a kilometre of the finish flag.
And the wind certainly is gusting up, 40-50 knots here at the moment, and it's predicted to get worse as the day goes on. It may have some effect on the racing overall. Rod Dixon getting the lines all nice and tidy, coming down to the start finish line over the Dunlop Bridge and approaching the start finish straight to get the checkered flag this time. And we'll just have a look at how big the gap is. Rod Dixon.
Under the Whittaker Bridge.
He really has won this by a huge margin, hasn't he?
Enormous margin. In fact, I think he's put more space between him and the second place getter than he did last year with John Gallagher.
So Murray Pierce, the All Black lock, is in second place.
Judith Kirk. Hamish Piercy.
Yeah, just holding out Hamish Piercy. Good drive from Jude Kirk.
Very well.
Handling the pressure well, sticking to second place. That's the order. Dixon, Murray Pierce, Jude Kirk, just holding out Hamish Piercy in four.
Well, I think Rod Dixon should be banned from the celebrity race. That's 2 years in a row he's won it with ridiculous ease. Far too serious, Rod Dixon. No, I'm just joking. Great drive by the former Olympic athlete, the Olympic bronze medalist from 1972. And one of New Zealand's fastest ever marathon runners, Rod Dixon, the winner for the second year in a row of the United UPlan Celebrity Race. Top drive from All Black lock, Murray Pierce for second. Murray Pierce just back off the plane, almost literally. Arrived home Monday or Tuesday this week, didn't he? And he's straight into the action here on the Wellington waterfront. Second place today. And third place going to Judith Kirk, popular hostess from the Sail of the Century. Jude Kirk getting in for third place, just ahead of Hamish Piercy, who was the public entrant in this year's race. He won the competition to get a start in the 10-strong field. Other people further back in the pack, Jeff Bryan, I think he was probably in about 6th or 7th, by Marama Taumanu, New Zealand netball captain, the Attorney General and former Prime Minister David Longhi, waving to the fans there as he comes around. But he was back in the pack. I suspect he might have had a little collision with a bit of Armco barrier or some tyres up about the sharp left-hander near the Michael Fowler Centre. The celebrity cars now just coming back to the start-finish line, all Nissan Sentras. And in fact, they are going to come all the way to the start-finish line. It's just a bit of a hold-up for them. Now they're coming into the pits. Murray Pierce on his way back now. Very, very windy day here in Wellington today. It's gusting consistently at 30 to 40 knots. So Rod Dixon coming down the start finish straight. He's the car outside the barrier on the racetrack proper, all the other cars lining up in the pits.
Jude Kirk in third place. And we'll wait now for the winner for the second year in a row, Rod Dixon. Runstrap himself. There's Murray Pearce. Great performer once again on the tour of Wales Ireland. Congratulations from Jude Kirk. John Cardwell's down there.
Hey Murray, what's the idea of picking on this woman here?
Just the way the race worked out, but great fun. And I don't think there was any damage, well, very little damage. So,
Judith, how do you feel about this guy barging past you?
Well, he spun out once. Was that you that spun out? Someone tried to pass me and spun out. But I know, I was coming second, but third's all right.
I was watching you coming past. You're getting quite excited about this.
The steering wheel, I think. I won't let him pass me. Aggressive about it, it surprises me.
Is it more exhilarating than you're flying?
On a par. On a par with it.
What about for you, Murray?
Oh, that was great. That was, I might look at taking up this career after rugby perhaps. I don't know. Well, time will tell. But...
Well, here's the meanie that beat you guys. Here he is, Rod Dixon. Rod, congratulations. You're getting a bit.
Oh,
it's birthday, isn't
it? Rod, this is getting to be a bit of a habit for you. Now, look, you're bitten by this bug, aren't you?
I am. It really is. It's a disease, and I don't think there's a cure. I didn't think, they knew that I went down the inside the first time. I didn't think they'd let me do that again. And when I saw it open up, I just took it.
How did you get through all that traffic at the start? Where did you get past? In the front straight, or did you wait till corner?
I got through to second place by going just down the wall. Everybody wants to do a right-hand turn. They open up a gap on the left, so I went down the left.
Murray, Judith, should we ban him from next year?
Oh, I think we should. It's getting too boring, too monotonous.
You've got to come back and beat me.
Oh, I'd love to. Actually, I'd love to.
That's the way they finished. Very interesting race, and obviously very exciting for those people who've never been in one before and get in a competitive situation. The pressure's on, and obviously some of them thoroughly enjoyed it, including Jude Kirk, Murray Pearce, and Rod Dixon, who's, as he says, absolutely smitten by the buck. Well, there have been a lot of other things happening here at the waterfront for 89, and as we warm up for the big race, the Nissan Mobil 500, let's have a look at the highlights of one of the races from this morning, the Formula Pacifics. Lined up ready for a start in the Philips Car Stereo Formula Pacific race over 20 laps. The two to watch right on the front, Jacques Villeneuve and Kenny Smith. Kenny Smith in his new Swift. Let's see how well he gets off the line in car number 11, the white Swift. He's using Ford power. Villeneuve is using Toyota power. Villeneuve is into it first, then Smith, then Craig Baird. 20 lap race, and they really were flying around here, David, yesterday.
Well, I think they opened up a few eyes. Even the Saloon boys thought that former Pacific cars with 1600cc engines wouldn't go that quickly. Look at Gilles Villeneuve's brother, Jacques Villeneuve from French Canada, streaking away now from Ken Smith in the new Swift EV4. Craig Baird in the Caltech Swift in third place. Then Barry Tomlinson fighting it out for fourth. Can't see at this moment who that's with, but Barry Tomlinson, a new competitor in Formula Pacific this year, another Kiwi in the front.
There's Jacques Villeneuve. He's the man who should be setting the pace. He is very experienced on street circuits, and he has raced even at Indy level, so you would have expected him to come here and run away from the field. His qualifying time, 1:25.24, 5 seconds quicker than the Group A cars, to give you some idea of comparison.
Well, you actually have to concede he is running away with this race. Look at that gap. It's not even one lap over this race. What a name to have on the streets of Wellington, Tony. Villeneuve. It's the name that conjured up magic in Formula One for many years. And, of course, we were never lucky enough to see him down here in some of those races with KK Rosberg. But Jacques Villeneuve living on the legend of the famous family and doing a great job for Graham Lawrence Motorsport in this lovely little Phillips Swift Toyota car.
He really is making it look easy as he just pulls away from this field. Kenny Smith in second place, Craig Baird third, and just look at that gap that he's pulled now. Looking at Heather Spurl in your picture there, a little down in the order. We had a little chat to her yesterday, Trish Stratford did, about a world record that she has secured just recently and about her attitude and her interest in Formula Pacific racing.
New Zealander Heather Spurl is the fastest woman on water. In fact, she holds the world championship title at 212 kilometres an hour. But this year, the call of the Nissan Mobil circuit was far too much. She's trading the Briney in for some paint, and she's imported a Formula Pacific car in from the States. In fact, the car itself has only arrived a couple of days ago. Is it a bit frantic to get it ready for the race, Heather?
It has been a bit frantic. It's been a few late hours put into it so far.
What's the difference between speed on the water and speed on the hard stuff?
The car tends to hide the true speed. I think you really do know you're going fast when you're out on the water, whereas the car, the sensation's quite a lot calmer.
Heather, you're already the fastest woman on water. Are you going to be the fastest woman at the Nissan Mobil?
I'm going to try very hard, yes.
Are you a speed freak?
I suppose I must be in a way. I enjoy the whole thing, the preparation, the getting it here, just the two of us. It's quite a challenge, and that's a good part of it as well. But once we're in the car, I suppose, yes, I must be.
The trophy for the world speed crown was late in coming. Ironically, it has arrived in time for the Nissan Mobil streetcar race. So in a back shed away from the media hype, David Longy did the honours.
Congratulations
on
that.
Thank you very much.
That's the certificate with it.
Thank you.
And that's the pennant. How long had you been driving boats before you did that?
Not very long at all.
So as you can see, she can run a car and the boat as well. Jack Villeneuve, Barry Tomlinson, Richard Lester, Ross Heffernan, Heather Spill, Craig Baird.
One of the problems, of course, of having a big lead is that if you try and slow down a little bit, you can lose your concentration. And that's why I think he's just keeping right on the pace. He's keeping everything sharp. He's not dropping off, because the minute you do that, you do tend to get into mistakes.
Yes, it's often something that confuses people. They expect that when you've got a huge lead that you would just back off and cruise a little and save the car, but for so many drivers that is the case, Trevor, where just backing off by even a second a lap, and what would seem to be easier, does reduce the concentration and mistakes creep in.
Well, he has backed off substantially that last lap, Tony. He actually dropped about 5 seconds, so I don't suspect there's a problem. However, we don't have that fancy communication that the Group A cars have, so boss Graham Lawrence has just got to look up the road, wait till that little car comes into sight. He's got his fingers crossed, because he knows this is a cruel track as far as biting the corners off these single seaters, and he'll be just grateful to see it come up that pit road in first place.
He certainly has done it all right. He put in a very, very quick lap, and then this last one has turned in a very slow lap. Assume he's being told there is the checkered flag for Jacques Villeneuve.
Is that it for you in New Zealand, or can we see you back here in January for our international series?
Well, I don't know really right now. I'm busy back home. I have a snowball racing to do starting next weekend until the middle of March. Unless I find something really interesting here, I might come over.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So there they are, confirmed the position, Jacques Villeneuve in the Swift DB4, winning by a country mile from Craig Baird and another of the Swifts. The first Rolt in third place, Barry Tomlinson, and the Rolt RT4 third, but a long way back.
The single-seater racing action from here on the Wellington waterfront this morning. Well, the big race is just under an hour away from the green light flashing. The 1989 Nissan Mobil 500 with Peter Brock in the 05 car, this year a Ford Sierra, on the pole position. Let's see, though, what some of the other drivers in the field have got to say about the Wellington Street Circuit that they're racing on this afternoon.
It's a challenging circuit. You can't make a mistake. I actually enjoy it as much as any other circuit we race on. It's a track you can be very, very aggressive. You can drive very, very hard. And it's a great place. I enjoy the race.
I love it. It's a little different to everywhere else. You make a mistake and it's terminal. But as a driver's track, it's fantastic.
You know, 500 kilometre race around Wellington, I think it's a matter of not making any mistakes and keeping going, and the guys doing a good job in the pits, and you have to have all the variables right to win this race.
I've been here four times and I've never won, so let's hope and keep our fingers crossed for this weekend.
This year they changed something. I just have done a lap around, walking around, and looks like they changed something, but it's not bad. I like the people can follow very well the race. It's very spectacular.
normally aspirated cars come into their own at the circuit. Both the Holden and BMW will be very, very impressive around here, I'm sure, compared to, say, how they are at Pukekohe or at Bathurst or some of those wide open tracks. The Nissans are going to be very, very fast. I think reliability, good driving, and slick pit work, is the combination of those is going to be required to win the race, not just a quick car.
The circuit suits the cars, even though the cars are underpowered by about 100 horsepower to the series, the top series. I think our cars will sort of last, but a bit more like the BMWs will.
I love the place. I enjoy street circuits, and over the years now, this has become as important as any touring car race in the world.
Well, I like running here because it's unique. There's nowhere else really that we get to run at a place like this. It's interesting, it's fun, and that's what it's all about.
So there we are, some thoughts, all very complimentary, we must say, about the Wellington Street Circuit. But it's a very windy day here in the Harbour Capital today. And even though the sun is shining, it's not all that pleasant, I wouldn't think, for spectators. A little bit of action out on the circuit before the big race starts. Whoops, almost went over then. Listen, if you'd like to hear the news of your favourites in that United U Plan celebrity race, here is the full list of results. After Rod Dixon won and Murray Pearce was second and Duke Kirk was third, the other placings are Hamish Piercy, who won the public competition. He came in fourth. David Longy, the Attorney General, was fifth. Fenella Barfield from 3:45 Live on TV2 was sixth. Jeff Bryan came in seventh, upholding the tradition of TVNZ Sports, coming in seventh place. Jim Hopkins was eighth. And Waimarama Taumanu in ninth place. Fiona Cram from the Krypton Factor, she was in 10th place. Now we have the drivers in the Group A section, and the Nissan Mobil 500 themselves going out for a little drive around the circuit to meet the crowd, which has gathered here at the Wellington Waterfront this afternoon. On the right there, you see Ian Gamble, one of the promoters for this meet. There's the BMW pairing, Roberto Rabaglia and Emanuele Pirro. Few problems apparently with their car. We've heard they've had to change their engine overnight, and one of our reporters was in the BMW pit before, and the news was not particularly optimistic for the BMW camp. They were rather worried, but there's certainly smiles all around for the defending champions, Rabaglia and Emanuele Pirro. Had to change an engine overnight, as we mentioned before, but they certainly look confident now. And there's an indication of just how strong this wind is today, with the white caps on the inner reaches of Wellington Harbour. So the Nissan Mobil 500 for 1989 is just over 45 minutes away. We'll be taking a break in just a little time. There's Peter Brock, the man on pole position, twice a winner of this race, both times in Holden Commodores. Peter Brock was here in a BMW last year. He wasn't really a factor. He's come back in a Ford Sierra. The Mobil dealer team has switched over to the Ford camp. And Peter Brock is going off pole this afternoon. His fastest qualifying time, 1:30.46. Crichton and Longhurst there. They're the car, the team that will start from second position on the grid. About 0.3 of a second, just under 0.3 of a second, behind Peter Brock and Paul Radishitz in their BMW. So we'll be leaving you now and returning at 1:30 after news review, the news for the deaf, with the race due to start at 1:45 this afternoon. Wellington is alive for the Nissan Mobil 500 of 1989. We'll be back with you in 30 minutes.
Coverage of the 1989 Nissan Mobil 500 is presented by Television One, Nissan and Mobil. Television One, Nissan and Mobil present coverage from the 1989 Nissan Mobil 500.
Welcome back to the Wellington Waterfront. Race time is 14 minutes away. The 1989 Nissan Mobil 500, still a windy day, albeit sunny, a little bit partly cloudy, but the white caps in Wellington Harbour tell the story. The weather forecast is for gale force winds up to 60 knots. Already a gust at 69 knots has been recorded this morning. They have been averaging 35 knots, so gale force winds expected to continue this afternoon, but there will be no rain. That at least is a small blessing. It's a very gusty conditions here with the race due to get underway in just under a quarter of an hour. A world-class field of 29 cars up here this afternoon with drivers from Australia, from Europe and from New Zealand. Peter Brock and the 05 car, the Ford Sierra from the Mobil dealer team, is on pole. But let's meet some of the drivers in this afternoon's race.
In the Schnitzer BMW M3 number one car, literally the two best touring car drivers in the world, Italians Emanuele Pirro and Roberto Revaglia. On pole in Sierra Cosworth RS 500, that evergreen Ocker Peter Brock and New Zealand's Formula Pacific ace Paul Radisich. Brock's already won here twice. In the number 17 Shell Sierra and ATC and Bathurst champion Dickie Johnson, paired with the Tasmanian ex-single-seater driver John Bow, they complete the front three Sierra lineup on the grid. Second fastest qualifiers in the B&H Sierra, another Aussie-Kiwi pairing. Tony Longhurst is very familiar with the circuit, and he's paired with Kiwi Neville Crichton. They're hoping for fine weather. And the fastest of the Nissan Skyline Turbos, expatriate Jimmy Richards and the young Australian star Mark Scaife. If anyone can, JR can, this might just be their day. In the second, Schnitzer Works BMW M3, Englishman Steve Soper and French pro Fabien Girouard. This is both backup to the number one car and a potential outright winner. In the Peanut Slab Sierra Cosworth, another Kiwi with an overseas connection, our own Robbie Francovic teams up with world-class Italian Gianfranco Brancatelli. They'll be there if the car's reliable. Car 50 is the locally entered BMW M3 with a top Kiwi pairing. Denny Holmes always quick here, and he has a perfect match in Brett Riley, both very experienced internationally. In the TV3 Sierra Cosworth Turbo are the two Andrews, Andrew Bagnall, the Kiwi with a growing touring car reputation, and Andrew Miedecki, who's seldom off the pace in anything he drives. In the second Nissan Turbo pairing, two good pros together, Wynn Percy, the Englishman who's driven Rovers, Jags and Commodores before here, and George Fury, the long-time Nissan stalwart.
So the cars lining up on the grid here on the Wellington Waterfront, Peter Brock and Paul Radisich in the Ford Sierra. 130.46 was their time in qualifying yesterday. They're off pole. Tony Longhurst and Neville Crichton also in the Ford Sierra, the Benson and Hedges Ford Sierra. 130.71 their time in practice yesterday. The flags of the hospitality area really telling the story of the weather conditions here in Wellington this afternoon. Well, one of the great stories of the Nissan Mobil 500 over the last couple of years has been the Schnitzer BMW team. The M3, driven by Roberto Revaglia and Emanuele Pirro, was the winner of this race last year, completing 152 laps and just the one pit stop required, whereas the Sierra's required two, and that could be a vital factor. Trish Stratford has been looking at the Schnitzer BMW team.
The team have hit town, the cars, the glamour and the women.
This is the reason because I'm here.
It's the glamour?
Not the glamour but the people. Because I like them, I like to be with them.
Yeah, it's good glamour.
Motorsport a lot is down to a team. I mean, the work in the race team is very hard. We have to stay together over the year for a very long time, and so obviously it is better if there is a very good understanding between the group of people who run this operation. And whatever I can do to motivate the people to have some fun in the team, I will do. First of all, what needs to be there, I think, is the will that you say, I want to give my utmost. I want to give the input I have into the team in order to make everything work well. This I expect from every mechanic who is with Schnitzer. And I mean, every mechanic has this. And apart from this, I also try them always to inform them of what we need to do for today.
I drive because
Basically because I like to drive with Schnitzer and I like to drive with Roberto. I started 5 years ago and we've been driving together all the time. And really the atmosphere which developed with Schnitzer, and especially when I drive with Roberto, is very unique. Because we've been racing so long together and because we did karting together and we started our career together, we have a lot of trust into each other. And once you overcome this stage of considering your teammate as a rival, then you can really work very, very strongly together. And so we only work to achieve a result. We don't work to impress the team, because we don't need to impress the team. And I think this is our strength.
Being the operative word, it's a close-knit group who not only drive, but socialise with flair.
And the winners of this race in car number one, the BMW M3, Roberto Rovaglia and Emanuele Pirro, starting from place number 7 on this year's grid, with Emanuele Pirro, who's had Formula One experience this year, to be the lead-off driver. The other car in the team will be going from number 9 with Fabian Giraud as the lead-off driver. Let's go to Tony Palmer now, and he'll tell us about the 3.21 kilometre circuit they're going to race over.
Thanks, Peter. I'd rather be where you are, I think, today. It is very, very windy, particularly up in the commentary box, and we're a little worried about being thrown off. Let's have a look at this circuit from the start-finish line. Winding up here, we have the first little kink is a right-hander. A little hard to see from the camera shot. And then they approach the hairpin, the Bridgestone hairpin. Very, very tight. First gear for many of the cars out of it. Little kink there. Coming up, turn right here, and out onto the street on the Gervois Quay. They change lanes along here. It's actually a straight, but they change from one side of a four-lane highway to the other. So just a kink in the armco. Straight line here, up around 140, possibly 150 miles an hour. Looking at the gear ratio charts. Hard left here, and that will catch a lot of them out. Down past Taranaki Street, Tory Street to Schaefer Street corner. A left and then a right, almost immediately afterwards. Very hard on brakes. Hard to keep off the armco here, the right hand. That takes them along a little straight here to a sweeper. And now the round onto the actual waterfront itself. The chicane coming up, the Nissan Mobil chicane, it will slow them down a little. Quite tight getting out of it this year. And then around to what has become an S section. Right on the waterfront and approaching the Dunlop Bridge, which has changed substantially from last year. That's the entry to it, and the exit here you'll see is quite tight too. A little kink that puts them out centre track and down to the start finish line again. That wee kink under the Whitaker's Bridge out of the start finish line again. That's a complete lap point. An interesting circuit. The changes are to the liking of some drivers and not others. Several of them have said that it makes it more interesting. Just a word with our commentators here today, David Oxen and Trevor Croke. If I could ask you, what do you think of the changes to the circuit? It certainly has made a difference, David, on the entry to the bridge. We'll come back to that in a moment. Meantime, let's just look at those grid positions. Brock and Radisich on the front, then Longhurst and Crichton, Johnson and Bow, Richards and Scaife, Johnson, Bow, cross entries, of course, going right down the list there. Soper and Giroir. Don't worry too much about where the BMW two team cars are on that grid. In a 4 hour race, it won't make a great deal of difference. And the 1600 class, of course, filled with Toyota Corollas. Plenty of those in the lineup. Class 2 includes all the BMWs, of course, up to 2.5 litre, and they're 2.3.
Corollas and one Mustang. 2635 BMWs at the to making up the field of 29 cars. 05 on your screen. Peter Brock, two-time winner of the Nissan Mobil.
The first time we've seen him in a Sierra. We'll have a look at that point I was making a little earlier on as we go around the circuit on the warm-up. But there is some controversy, in fact, as to whether this circuit is better or not as good as last year. I think it has actually made more passing points on it, but it will be harder, perhaps, on brakes. There is some argument over whether it is more bumpy or less than last year. Certainly, I don't think it's less bumpy. And all of them have had some trouble under brakes, particularly at the end of the straight.
Well, the lap times are near enough the same. Qualifying was within a second of last year, so the circuit's just got pushed out of one area and pulled out of another. So in effect, no problems. It's still a street circuit. It's still a big challenge. And the rules are still the same. Keep off the walls if you want to finish this race.
Yes, I personally don't think it's any bumpier. I think it's just that your memory forgets how bad it was last year, and you get here and you think, my goodness, this is really bumpy. I think the circuit's very similar in terms of bumps. So I think the new part, the only difference is you're coming into the bridge from the other side. As George Furey said yesterday, it's much the same as the old track. You're just coming at it from a different angle. But when I ran around there last night, there were an awful lot of skid marks onto the new part where the big S-bend is, and it looks like people are having trouble there.
Sierras will be looking to break this jinx they seem to have here. People forget that the Eggenberger team cleaned up in 1987 here, of course. But, well, BMW have got this thing about their superb reliability, their superb team management, their superb mechanics. And I can tell you, though, that there's a whole bunch of Sierras out there. The Dick Johnson Shell team, and the Peter Brock Mobile team, the Andrew Bagnall team with the budget car, and, of course, Tony Longhurst, the recent winner of Adelaide, all trying to prove that they have the Sierra, which has not just got the speed, but the reliability. And don't discount the Nissans, Jim Richards and Wyn Percy, of course.
Without being disparaging, I would think it's a severe indictment of Ford Sierras if they can't get a win out of this. They have the most horsepower, they have a good enough range of competitive cars, and it would be an indictment on their reliability if they can't match wits with BMWs, of which, of course, there are two in the Schnitzer team, and they can run all day at the maximum speed, or 9.5 tenths, with no question about their reliability until this morning, when it was revealed that they actually had to replace an engine as well. The Nissans have had problems with turbocharger, the BMWs have had an engine problem, the one or two of the Sierras have had some brake problems, but in theory and on paper, which is never the case in a race, of course, it should be a Sierra race.
Tony, I think it's horses for courses, and this is the circuit in the world for these little BMWs. So personally, I think they really would be my favourite at this stage if they can keep going.
Well, Charlie Lamb would love to have you feeling right now. Charlie Lamb, team manager of the Schnitzer team, not 100% happy. He said in his nice German, or nice English from German, not completely happy that they have eradicated the electrical problem. These high-tech cars with their electronic management and fuel systems controlled by computers, they can't always just look at them and say it is fixed. You have to go back to the tried and true method of go out there and try it, and there's just no way they can try it. They're now on the warm-up lap and they're all fingers crossed.
That, of course, is part of the magic of a street race. No time to practice.
Can I just say, watching these cars now and having driven here last year, my heart's thumping away at the moment. I'm not even in the car, but I can remember the feelings as you approach the start of a race like this. You're trying to concentrate on why you're there. Everything's racing. Your heart's racing. Your thoughts are racing. You're looking around you. You're thinking ahead for the first few corners of the race, which are very critical. I'm just about sitting in those cars myself at the moment, and I'm getting pretty excited myself.
And you've got to bear in mind, of course, that it's not corner one, lap one, that's the big race. They've got a start. It looked initially as though they wouldn't on that lap. They've given them the green and they're away. So Longhurst on the inside from Brock. Longhurst takes it off Brock first corner. But remember, lap one, turn one, doesn't matter too much. Expect the Sierras to run away and hide initially.
That's Johnson up to third place. And one of the Nissans up into fourth. That's the Jim Richards car, Jim Richards driving. That was a neat bit of, well, almost barging there by Tony Longhurst. He just made the road go awfully narrow for Brockie, and Brockie had to back off. That gave him at least 50 metres advantage, and he's still holding it. He's got a reasonably line out onto the back of Schaefer's there. He's still got the place. Brockie challenging.
Well, this is going to be a little battle up front. Rest assured of that. Peter Brock was squeezed from that. And so the three Sierras, Longhurst, and then Brock, and then Dickie Johnson. And let them run away just a little.
Well, Johnson won't be worried too much. He told us beforehand, Neil Lowe translated what he had said, which was, if the pace is all right, Dick's not going to try and race for the front right at the start. But if those boys in front of me, if there are any in front of me, aren't going quick enough, then watch me try to barge through. So what the Sierras are trying to do is get a break on the BMWs. They know that an endurance race favours BMW, and with the new rules for pace cars coming out, that also helps the BMW. So the Sierras have got to make this break.
Yes, we could perhaps just explain at this stage that rules are in force for this year's race, whereby anything on the track, any car that breaks down, whether it crashes or not, if it is on the track, it must be moved, which means pace car, which means any gap that you have built up may dissipate very quickly. So those three Sierras starting to run away, in fact four Sierras, because Brancatelli in the Brancatelli-Prankovic car is in fourth place. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and then the Nissans.
Knowing Tony Longhurst as well as I do, having driven with him, I think part of the man is just pure racer, and I don't think he's capable of driving slowly anyway. Dick and Johnson, I think he'll keep going for it. Sorry, Trevor. Dick Johnson going by Brock. Now that was an advantage which almost looked like a power advantage. Now whether Brock had missed a gear up that straight, but not normally would you see Brocky give away that much ground so quickly. That's opening up now.
And Brancatelli in the peanut slab car, the brown car, in fourth place there, closing on Brock as well. There's Longhurst, then Johnson, then Brock, Brancatelli and Richards.
Lap times are really meaningless now in relation to qualifying, but we do know that 1 minute 36, 1 minute 37, we're going to see a pace around about the 134, 135. That's what the drivers all believe. But Longhurst, showing a bit of the form which allowed him to win both races at the Adelaide Grand Prix meeting and a previous Bathurst victory, will put a smile, a broad smile on Frank Gardner's face, because that's just nice placing at this point of the race. Here's a bit of action. Brancatelli through on Brock. Brock Forster concede that place now.
Doesn't look wonderful for Brock, does it? I mean, he's a very calm head, but we need a closer look, perhaps, that we've seen in both of those incidents to know whether it was just forcing him wide or if he's still warming brakes or something.
No, I think he's got a problem, Tony. He's just not that sort of driver that he would let people go through that easily. Well, he hasn't been known to be that courteous, has he? And after all, he is the pole sitter. He was the one that plucked the fastest lap. The Nissan's there on screen at the moment, just holding station in fifth and sixth position. Jim Richards leading from George Fury in the second Nissan. So it's Tony Longhurst from Dick Johnson, from Brancatelli, Peter Brock in 05, the two Nissans in fifth and sixth.
That's good position for the Nissans too. They didn't wind up the wick to qualify. They knew that they could maintain a fairly good race pace, and their view last night was that the Sierras would not be able to run away. They might creep away, but they sure as hell weren't going to leave them sitting there.
Well, we just said the race pace is expected to be 34s. Already Dick Johnson's done a 33-0. So, they're really going for it. And I tell you what, that Brancatelli has got the bit between his teeth, and he's got Dick Johnson in his sights.
We always said that the question over the car in third place, the Whittaker Peanut Slab car, would be reliability. I don't think there's any question marks over the driver in there at the moment, Gianfranco Brancatelli. He can hold this pace with these fellas, no trouble at all, so long as the car holds up. And in the pits already, it's Richard's car.
Well, that was something Neil Lowe said. He said, keep an eye out for the garbage on this track. With the wind around here, it's going to blow up all sorts of stuff. Air intakes will be crucial, especially for turbo cars, because they heat up very, very quickly as soon as their air is restricted.
So it was just to clear the air. That may well happen.
Brancatelli through to second place.
Amazing. Well, we said there is no question mark over Brancatelli as a driver. There has been the odd question mark over the car and the amount of time that they had in preparation. But there he is chasing Longhurst past Dickie Johnson.
Tony, let me tell you what I think's happening here. Well, in a moment. In fact, Tony Longhurst not with us at that moment, but there's Tony Longhurst with us right now, leading the Nissan Mobil. What I think is happening is this, for the first time, is one of the times when the drivers are admitting they are varying the boost from the driver's seat. Now let's explain this. These cars in your picture now, first, second, third, fourth and fifth, are all powered by engines assisted by a turbo. A turbo is just a big blowing fan which is drawing gases, pressure from the exhaust system and forcing them back in the air intake, and that just means bulk horsepower, makes them go fast. Now what is happening, they're winding up the boost because now at Wellington they are allowed to.
And this is interesting, they're only about a quarter of a lap away from lapping the back markers this early in the race, giving an indication of the speed differential between the Sierras out front and some of the others in the field. That's a good battle developing there. Longhurst, Brancatelli, Johnson, and then Brock. Brock doesn't seem to have lost any more ground, but you've got to wonder what the problem is to have let those two through.
It could be, Tony, Bridgestone tyres have a very good advantage when it comes to qualifying, but in a race situation they may not have the perfect brew for Peter Perfect himself. That car there on your screen now is a Dunlop car. That car behind them is a Dunlop car. So Dunlop seem to have got things sorted out. Dick Johnson, we know, is running on Dunlops. So right at the moment, right at this circuit on this day, it seems possibly Dunlop has the best combination. We do know that there is Yokohama tyres on the BMW, but Peter Perfect has the only Bridgestones in the race.
They're just confirming that order for you. Longhurst, Brancatelli, Johnson, Brock, and then Fury.
Brancatelli, of course, is really one of the best drivers. He's actually driven in Formula One at one stage. He comes with a really good record, and he's a real hard pusher. I wouldn't be surprised to see him in the lead before too long.
Well, I would suspect, Trevor, right at this point, the form is almost established. Those two cars are going to be the rabbits. Brock, if he's elected to drop back with his tyre situation, if it is a tyre situation, I mean, he's not out of a bad position, but he's probably, like Johnson appears to be, conceding that these two blokes can go and do the pacemaking. As long as their pace is okay, as long as they stay within sight, and as long as they keep in the 1 minute 33 zone, they're all right. These blokes are just going to have to sort their own little race out between them.
One of the problems that Tony Longhurst has is that his co-driver isn't actually as quick as he is by 2 or 3 seconds a lap, and Tony needs a good break at this stage if he's to maintain a good pace right through the race.
Now, as you suspected, Trevor, we've got a battle here. Brancatelli is certainly right on Longhurst. He's making up the gap nicely and smoothly. I suspect you're right in that he's going to be climbing all over Longhurst very shortly. This is great for Mark Petch's team and for Robbie Brancevic, because there are plenty of cynics around this circuit who would have had this car out of the race before halfway.
Not halfway yet, Tony.
See what I mean?
Now, their record of reliability with this car over the last two seasons has not been very good. Bathurst, they were very fast, but they didn't finish. I imagine that both drivers are pretty hard on their machinery. I know Robbie is a real trier, and obviously Brancatelli is one of those professional guys that he's just going to push the car to its limits to get the result that he thinks he wants.
Last lap times tell a story. Brancatelli with 33.86 and Longhurst 34.25.
That's what I was getting at, Tony. They've gone slightly off the boil, like they were back, they were in the 33s early on, so I suspect that they gave it a bit of hard boost for those initial laps, wound it back now to make sure the temperature's normalised, and just obviously, as Trevor's just pointed out to me, the tyres are a factor here too. You chase those tyres for a few laps, giving them a real hard time on the corners, and literally they overheat and lose all grip, so you can't keep chasing them. So the boys ease back just a fraction. Second a lap is nothing, but boy, it's a lot when saving tyres.
Yes, I was talking to one of Tony Longhurst's mechanics earlier, and he said that Tony's style is so press on that unless he thinks about it, he is very hard on his tyres.
We'll be back very shortly on the waterfront. That's the way they sit at the front of the field at the moment. Longhurst, Brancatelli and Johnson. just in time, I think, to see the later stages of the development of this race at the front. Gianfranco Brancatelli right on Tony Longhurst's tail of those two Sierras, having run away slightly from Dickie Johnson in third place and Brock in fourth place. All Sierras at the moment. The Sierras needing to pull this break. They will need two full stops. The Nissans need one on the top up. The BMWs only need one stop.
As Tony said earlier, let's remember that any incident at all which leaves a car stopped on the track will bring out the pace car for as long as it takes for a tow truck to remove the vehicle. Now that rule must be maybe tailor-made for the BMWs, which at this point are holding position 7 and 8. Can't see them on screen, don't worry about them. They're just percolating nicely, about a second a lap off the pace of the leading Sierra. But already Manuele Pirro in the number one BMW, the Sali car, is biting at the back of the second mobile Ford Sierra. Now there's a little bit of a problem there for a slower car. We can't see which car that was, gone off screen. So we're into lapping already. Tony Longhurst going by the Brian Bate Andrew Marr car. That's one of the important Toyotas from Japan.
One of the things that may occur, because there's no question somebody will bounce off a wall here, it always happens, at least one or two in the space of a race, is that we could end up with a series of sprint races, because if you bring out the pace car, you're not allowed to overtake, but there's nothing to stop you closing up the gap if the pace car comes out in front of the lead car. Now, all of a sudden, Brancatelli in the Whittaker Peanut Slab Sierra, the brown one, is dropping back.
He's lost a bunch of time there. Now, is it serious? Longhurst sideways, and very, very closely. Wow, he almost clobbered those tyres there, Trevor.
Yes, I think it just follows up what I was saying earlier, that if you drive this hard this early, you're going to overheat your tyres, and that's why the lap times are starting to drop back, but it's also why Tony's getting very sideways out there.
That was a lucky break there for Brancatelli, who appeared to have lost the momentum to stay with Longhurst, suddenly got it all back when Longhurst went real wide in the chicane. Let's see if we can catch this on replay.
Well, I think it was actually a case of one and one, wasn't it? One all, because Brancatelli got balked initially, and then Longhurst got balked.
Okay, well, we won't blame Tony for that one, Trevor. He just found the road going a little bit tighter than he thought. The land just got a bit short on space. Samara in the L635 just changed the apex a little bit.
I think perhaps really he was braking a fraction later than I would have been. And in the end, he just had to slide through the corner. But a good save by Tony in that situation. It's a really difficult corner to do that in.
But you have to wonder at the problem. If your tyres start going off this early in the race and you back off to save them, how much damage can you afford to do before they're irreparably damaged?
Yes, well, it's not my style of driving a long-distance race. As you probably know, I'm always there at the finish if I can be, but it's just not Tony's way. He is a racer. He has to go flat out all the time, and that's virtually what he's done here.
The owner of the Robbie Francovic Ford Sierra. Mark, you weren't on the front row of the grid earlier on, but this race strategy you've got at the moment, is that what was planned?
No, I can't say it was, Tony. We planned to be on the front, but we had a problem with the car yesterday, and we only fixed it overnight, and we were the quickest this morning, so we knew the car was competitive. And as you can see now, you know, apart from the traffic, Brancas is having a good run, and we just planned to, if he can run in front, he will. If he's happier to run behind him, I'm really leaving it over to Brancas.
Mark, how long will it be before he comes in for his first scheduled stop?
I'm bringing him in an hour and 20 exactly, because we haven't done enough mileage to ascertain exactly what the fuel usage will be. So I'm going for safety here at an hour and 20.
Thanks, Mark, and good luck for the race.
That's the difference in what Mark Petch is saying between a team like Schnitzer and a team like his, in that they don't know exactly what that Sierra will do. That Sierra in second place, the brown one there, they don't know what it will do exactly under these conditions on a tank of gas. So they may have to come in earlier than would be optimum, just to be sure, because the last thing you want to do is run out of gas halfway around the circuit.
Mind you, Tony, most teams by now would know exactly how many laps they'll do on a tank of gas. You know, there's ways of measuring it. Even in, you can do 10 laps or 15 laps at race pace and multiply that by the number of laps you intend to do. So I think they probably have a pretty good idea. They're just being a little cautious coming in perhaps a couple of laps earlier than they otherwise would.
Let's watch down the end of the chute, Tony. If Branca's going to wind up the boost down here and dive for a position, let's just see if he's going to go down the inside. I would say he's got it.
Not so so much winding up the boost. Probably good slipstreaming, getting what they call a toe, and then able to pull out from behind and overtake under brakes.
Again, these enormous gaps open up, Tony, and now these are not normal as far as what we've been used to seeing in the street race. I mean, this 50 metres just opened up like that, and Longhurst seemingly unable to answer it, or does he not want to? Let's re-watch that overtaking manoeuvre.
Just hopping out of the slipstream, bursting past, braking a little later, through on the inside line, Longhurst going probably wider than he needed to, leaving it as late as he could, and then all of a sudden, as David said, a 50 metre gap just opened up like that. So Brank is on the pace. Gianfranco Brancatelli leads the Nissan Mobil 500 from Tony Longhurst, and Dick Johnson still in third place.
Tony's trying to put a smile on the face of Robbie Francovic if we could see him right now, because it's a long while since Robbie's cars have actually run as well as this.
Tony's times have actually dropped off in the last couple of laps, and I'm quite sure that you'll find that it's a tyre problem, that he pushed so hard in those first few laps he's just overheated his rear tyres, and these cars have got so much horsepower, if you're not able to get it on the ground, your lap time's going to drop.
Obviously Sachs and Gulson have retired in the M3.
Dent in the front guard of that car, but that's the car that had a big moment at Bathurst, and they've comprehensively rebuilt it. Disappointing for them. Brancatelli's actually opening up quite a gap now. I think now he's on his own. He's able to drive his own race and his own lines. And he's just going to quietly increase that gap by the look of it.
Those of you following the Division 3 cars, Joe McAndrew and Bob Holden in the Toyota Corolla GT are already in the pits with a jammed gearbox. Meanwhile, the race continues out front. Brancatelli into the traffic now, starting to lap some of the slower markers here. Down in the pits, we'll get a closer look there.
Car 43, that's the Ford Mustang, of course, the only Ford Mustang in the event, probably an old Dick Johnson car.
Bruce Fleming and David Slater. They're out again, but well off the pace.
But having a good time, I would think, entering what they know is an uncompetitive vehicle, but happy to do so, to get a race at this, you know, one in a lifetime chance really for some of these guys, and they really go for it.
Well, I've got to tell you that this is one of the closest battles at the front that we've seen in this Immobile. We're used to seeing the rush out and make their foot. Last year, certainly, there was all sorts of drama within the first few laps. But the first five cars, two of which are in your screen now, are covered by no less than 5 seconds. Now, that's good, this closer to the start. 13 laps, it mightn't seem like long, but they're pressing on, these guys. Brancatelli in your screen. Just going by the Mustang. Getting a little break there, getting past that slow Mustang and putting the little Longhurst there off the line. Just another half second gain to a second on that lap. Brancatelli, known for his ability in running 24-hour races. Been before with the, in fact it was a Schnitzer car, but it ran in different colours. And he had unceremoniously buried it into the Armco around the back there where the anchors used to be kept in the old days. But making no mistakes and keeping a nice clean nose of things around here today.
Brancatelli is an Italian. He's driven for Alfa, BMW, Volvo, Rover and BMW again. And now here he is in a Ford. So he's a man with a fair bit of experience.
This is Longhurst in second place, not having lost a lot since a lap ago. And the equal gap again back to Dick Johnson. Meanwhile in the pits very early on.
Well, that's the Brett Riley car. That's the
Jenny Hoff and Brett Riley. I'm not sure what the problem is, but it's too early to be in the pits.
Well, the looks on the faces worry. Whenever you see a mechanic shaking his head, it's a worry. I mean, they're obviously aware that there's some problem they can't fix immediately. They'd like to. They're talking about blocks of wood under the car there. That's because they want to raise it up higher. So you suspect transmission problems, gearbox, drive shaft, clutch, whatever. They want it up high because those blocks of wood are needed to get the extra height.
These guys are actually running the 6-speed gearbox in this car, and the factory team is running the 5-speed because they weren't sure about the reliability of the 6-speed box. So it may be something to do with that.
Jim Richards' car coming on in, and again, it's very early days. They've had problems with two turbos on these Nissan cars already in the last 2 days.
Fred Gibson said, we've changed the engine. We don't know what's happening with these turbos. Has he gone to the turbo side of the engine? I can't tell. He's looking down there at the turbo inlet. So they've had problems with the turbo getting so hot that the nuts are coming loose. And it would suggest that what he's doing is feeling the nuts to see if the turbo's coming loose. That's a problem that used to plague the Sierras. Fred can't figure out what's going wrong. He said it's probably the only part we don't make in-house now in his factory back in Melbourne. So they're just going to have to get down and redesign the whole turbo manufacture and assembly. He wasn't braving humans. There's just something wrong with the process of assembly of these turbos.
Now, if that car goes out, we're likely to see Jim Richards into their second car. They have cross-entry, as you see the three names there. Richards and Scaife driving this one, and Percy and Fury in the other. But they're all cross-entered. So whichever car continues to go, they will keep running it and put their best drivers in.
Poor Jim hasn't had a great run at Wellington. It's been a little unkind to him over the years. He drove with me 1 year and we had driveline problems with the car. But he's pretty reserved, sort of a resigned sort of a bloke. And you'll be sitting there thinking, oh, well, if I get back out, I'll do this and I'll do that. He's not a helmet thrower and he's not a sconder.
Well, that is a worry. Fury's out in the other one, and we imagine they'll put Richards in at the next stop if they don't get going again. There's John Carbwell, has Mark Scaife.
Mark, you know what
there.
The problem is?
I'm not sure yet. I think it's Jimmy just came in and said it's got no boost, so the boys are just checking that now.
Was this the car that was in trouble before?
Yeah, the car had paper over the radiator on the first lap, so we're in a bit of trouble before, yes.
Well, Jimmy's taking his helmet off, so it looks like it could be all over.
Yeah, it looks like it.
Bad luck, Mark.
Thank you.
Mark Scaife looks as though he may not get a run. If Jim Richards is taking the helmet off, then that's not nice. Yeah, he's out of it. He's a philosophical sort of a fella. He won't get too upset about it. And it's quite likely, we'll check it out, but it's quite likely we'll see him in the other car at the next stop.
Well, back at the front of the race, nothing has changed. Brancatelli still easing away now. He's got a 2.75 second advantage over Tony Longhurst, second place in the Ford Sierra, Benson and Hedges Ford Sierra, which he shares with Neville Crichton. So Brancatelli on your screen, number 11. Seemingly no problems here. Lap times 134.6.
It's 10 seconds back to the BMWs now, and I'm trying to work out, with one less fuel stop, whether in fact they can get through to win this race. It's too early to tell, but if they've lost 10 seconds this far, maybe it'll bring them pretty even by the end of the race if the Sierras hold their pace.
By the way, good picking, boys, on the Denny Hall Brett Riley car. Six-speed gearbox seems to have been the problem. Perhaps the Schnitzer Works team were very wise in using the five-speed.
They're actually quite a cheap gearbox, aren't they? Trevor, I heard sort of $30,000 or $40,000 will buy you another one.
That sounds bad. I think I'd rather have a house.
Well, that one probably have to go back under warranty.
Yes, it's really disappointing so early in the race. You know, I really feel for these guys. You build up for these things for weeks. You do all the organisation. You have your mechanics here. Heaps of work goes in, and then something happens this early in the race. And it really does deflate the team.
I'm sure we've all been in this position before, and we're talking about those few moments when the drivers are warming up for the start of the race. And you tell yourself, now, I must be nice to the car. There's no point. Oh, there's a big smoke up. That looks like it's locked up almost. Now, that's the turbo this morning failing on the Jim Richards car.
And it looks as though they have had a similar problem again, whether it was from newspaper over the intake blowing up on it, but that's the way it came smoking into the pits this morning, and the fire brigade were there very quickly. There were a few flames, I can tell you as well.
It was impressive to see the fire support, Tony. The fire engine followed that car into the pits. Not a problem of worry of safety. But as I said, the drivers go around in this first little session, they're saying, I must be nice to the car. We've come a long way. We need to look after the equipment. There's no sense in racing man out for the first half hour. And yet usually you find these gearbox problems that are generated in the first half hour are because of impetuous driving.
when it comes down to it, when the flag drops, you're all loonies, aren't you? Anyway, we'll go down to the pits and see if we can get a word with Jimmy Richards and find out what the problem is and what's going to happen re-cross entries.
Jim, what actually happened with the Nissan that time?
Lack of boost pressure, which means the engine hasn't got any power, so it's no good continuing.
It's a pretty sad time for you here in Wellington. It happened last year too with Peter.
Oh yes, that's the way it goes. We've had a good year up till now, and you know, we haven't been able to carry on with it, but that's the way it goes.
Is that your day, or will you hop in the other car?
No, that's it for me. I'll watch and cheer at George on.
Okay, we look forward to seeing you with more luck in Pukekohe.
Thank you.
Okay, so Jim seems to think that he's not going to go in the other car, so they'll leave the other team intact. The cross entry was for that purpose, but they're going to leave Fury and Wyn Percy out there.
Georgie Fury in the second, this in the number three car, is actually pressing Peter Brock real hard. Now, that's probably not in the book of rules. The Sierra should be streaking away from the field, like Brancatelli is here on your screen. But Peter Brock in fourth place, being pressed real hard by George Fury in the second Nissan Skyline.
Yeah, Brock has never looked quite right in this race. I can't quite work out why, but it just isn't really his style to be this far back. And I'm sure that's the car's as good as any of the other Sierras. So I just wonder if there's something a little amiss there.
Well, he's won more races here than we have, and I've got to imagine there's a plan. There's got to be a plan. He's probably quite happy to let this guy go and do his thing, because he's probably convinced the Brock organisation has probably got the wherewithal to beat this team. But, hey, we're up here and they're down there. We'll try and update you as we're here.
Still Gianfranco Brancatelli leading the Nissan Mobil 500. From Longhurst, from Johnson, from Brock. Brancatelli is driving the wheels off that car. He really has pulled out a lead since he got past Longhurst. There's Longhurst in your picture now with Johnson right on his tail. So Johnson has caught up Longhurst, or Longhurst has dropped back into his clutches.
As Robbie keeps telling us, this car was very quick at Bathurst, something like third fastest. And Robbie was so confident that it would be on the pace, and sure enough, Robbie's right.
Let's go to the pits anyway and see if we can get a word with Brett Riley down there with John Carbo.
Brett, the race is only half an hour old and already you're in the pits and it looks like a retirement. What's the problem?
I'm afraid it's a terminal problem, Brian. The gearbox is jammed in one of the gears and it's just not going to come out again. It's probably second, third gear, and it's stuck in there and it's not coming out. So that's it, you know.
Brett, did you have any prior warning to it?
Not really, no. It's going okay. Not a problem. Then all of a sudden just into second or third and then it was all over. Just stuck in there, couldn't get it out. I've had a look. You know, there's not a lot you can do short of taking the gearbox out of the car now, so that's it.
Brett Riley, thanks very much.
So Brett Riley out of it. Unfortunately, his pairing with Denny Holm has seen its day for this Nissan Mobil anyway. Hard luck so early in the race.
Tony, there's a big one. Brancatelli mounting on the side. Now that's the sort of thing that should not happen. That guy was leading the race by less than 5 seconds. He's given the lead away. He's going to have to stop now, change the bumper. Impetuousness, he did not need to do that there.
Yeah, it's a bit hard to say without looking at a slow-mo replay, but it looked like he might have got a serve there.
Well, he's mounted up the inside of the Lambden Bow Repairs car. That's it right on your screen now, the two cars in fact that were involved. I would suggest the Bow Repairs car was already going into the pits, slowing, and Brancatelli's just come up on him, literally mounted him.
This is always a problem with slow traffic on a tight circuit like this. There's nowhere to go, and if somebody closes the door like that, what are you going to do? That's a lot of damage. I can't see them getting that car out in good racing form in a hurry. I'd say the suspension has probably bent. Obviously the wheels are back a bit further. Yes, he's obviously getting out because there's a problem.
Let's talk to Neil Lowe about that with the Dick Johnson team. And it takes very little to bend the front of these cars.
This guy is not all that happy. We should watch this and just see what's happening here.
Maybe he will talk with his hands in a minute.
Listen to that Italian going. He is not happy. Brancatelli is furious, and I feel probably with justice. I'm pretty sure he was just plain cut off, really.
I thought he got a serve, really. I mean, sure, you can get yourself in trouble very easily, but let's have a look at it again. I thought that Commodore really gave him a serve. We'll get a look at it in a moment. Mark Petch is obviously upset, but as we were saying, these Sierras are so easy to ding that you can bend the front of them very, very easily. This was the little incident.
Well, maybe he shouldn't have been trying to get in there. You know, there wasn't really a gap.
In fact, it wasn't one outside.
Closing.
It was two outside.
Yeah.
So the fellow outside him was being forced in.
Yes, I think maybe he just went in where perhaps there wasn't going to be room to get through. But obviously the damage is terminal. That's oil dripping off there. They're not going to get the car fixed in a hurry.
So you might keep me on then, Trevor.
Well, there you are. History repeats itself. You must remember that team won the very first one of these Wellington Street races, Mark Peach's hands. And that was a Volvo that came straight off the plane. They brought it here and they raced it without touching it and won a race. What does that mean?
Well, whatever it is, it's sad to see a performance like that just wiped out of the race. But that's what street racing is about. You just got to keep your nose clean. You keep people hearing people say you've got to keep your nose clean, keep off the walls. Because had that been a road circuit, I mean a grass circuit, should we say, like Pukekohe, what have we got here? Some interesting mileage.
Some sort of race cam, that is.
Well, it's a race cam, as you can obviously see, whether it's the one on the Brancatelli car or... In fact, it's a Nissan. It's the third place Nissan of George Fury. Remember, the placings now have changed back to Tony Longhurst in the lead from Dick Johnson in the Shell Sierra second, and that's only by 2.8 seconds. So suddenly, the top three or four in the field are covered by no more than, 20 seconds, because according to our information, Ravaglia has dropped away from his sixth position, and that has elevated his teammate up to fourth. So our official Unisys computer is showing Longhurst leading from Johnson, from Fury, from the Sofa Giro BMW M3, that's the number two car, then Andrew Bagnall and Peter Brock.
I think his break is in the pits. I wouldn't like to interview him right now, would you? We'll see if we can get away with him when he's cooled down a little bit. But he was pretty grumpy. So here's the race leader, Tony Longhurst. Behind him, Dick Johnson. There's a reasonable sort of gap back there now, second place. But that threat, Brancatelli, he drove so well to get up there. He was going beautifully on pace, and his race has just been wiped out like that.
Johnson's keeping nicely in touch. He's keeping far enough back from Tony to keep his car cool, because the turbo cars can't follow close for long before they start to overheat with lack of air through the radiators. And I'd say he's conserved his car a little better early on. And with the strength of their driver pairing, because Bowe is very, very quick, just as quick as Johnson really, I'd say they are looking pretty good at this stage. But with these races, you can never call it this early because you're always wrong.
What I find amusing about watching Johnson here is that obviously somebody has got him, whether it's Neil Lowe, the team boss, or whether it's somebody in influence has actually got to Dick Johnson and said, you don't actually need to be 300 miles in front. It's actually reasonably sensible to do what you're doing right here.
Well, I'll tell you what, Tony, there is this belief that these Sierras have 450 horsepower. Now, if we are going to believe what Neil Lowe said, and I have no reason not to, he said that they are using 450 horsepower today because they can't use the 550 horsepower model turbo and management system to a good effect. So they've wound back the horsepower to make the car more drivable and actually give them the ability to work the car and the tyres and the suspension the way it's designed to. So I suspect that what you're seeing is actually Dick just being controlled by both himself and his team to say, we can win this race from this position, not a problem.
I would have to say on driver combination, I agree with you, Trevor, that where Johnson's sitting at the moment does look good, because Neville Crichton, when he gets in Longhurst's car, will not be able to maintain precisely the same lap speeds. He will be a little off it, whereas Bauer will be very, very easily. They are absolutely equal.
Pretty impressed to see Fury up so close too. He's actually keeping up quite comfortably. And I'd say they could just be there at the end as well.
We'll be back on the waterfront in just a moment. As we leave you, the order is Longhurst, Johnson, Fury, Ravaglia.